exhibition, the interactive histories, and one of so the term is self-historicization. That refers to any informal system of historicization that is practiced by artists who, because of the lack of suitable collective history, have to search for their own historical and or interpretative contexts. In many parts of the non-Western world, such as Eastern Europe, during the socialist period and even later, the local institutions that should have systematized neo-avant-garde art either did not exist or took a dismissive attitude towards such art, mostly neo-avant-garde art. Consequently, the artists themselves were often forced to archive documents relating to their own art, the art of the artists, or broader art movements, as well as the conditions of production. Self-historicization can be found in a number of different international contexts and should in no way be viewed as the exclusive domain of non-Western artists. Nevertheless, given the existing interest of globalizing art system, we need to draw special attention to the difference within a world that seems increasingly homogeneous, especially the differences between regions that are less standardized and regulated and those that are more so. It is in this context that I view the significance of self-historicization, which in some places still represents one of the most important, if not the only, form of historicization. Among other things, self-historicization reminds us that the dominant system of art history is unable to present the state of affairs in global world of differences. It is only superficially adapting the new situation, mainly by including more and more art from around the world. But even as they do this, they remain essentially the same, and indeed only further strengthen their power. Today, the large hegemonic museums in the major Western art centers loudly claim to be presenting the global history of art. That's another term that is getting very much repeated. But they continue to speak about the history in the singular and from a singular point of view. The Centre Pompidou, for example, is going global, the director says. Their main objective, however, is to preserve their influence and accumulate as many works as possible for their own new universal collections. The primary motivation behind these new universal histories reminds ownership. And this is something that is impossible to oppose through counter-narratives, which sooner or later would be incorporated in the dominant stories. Such processes need to be exposed once and for all as processes of alienation. We need to advocate a multiplicity of narratives, ones that include transparent processes of their own emergence and their true location. Here, a special place is occupied by self-historicization, which is tied to the lasting and personal presence of the narrator. The archives of self-historicization include local marginalized art traditions presented by archivists, not from some external objective position, rather their own personal involvement. And these traditions is viewed as essential. This involvement. The artists are not merely interested in correcting existing histories. where I want to bring attention to fundamental principles underlying the creation of these histories, the involvement of the individual, which always means excluding something. In place of universal collections based on the concept of power, they advocate universal archives, which all the, with all the heterogeneity, lack of system, and incompleteness inherent to such endeavors. Art archives created in self-historicization processes underscore more than local identities, the universal experience of otherness. They are not so much about documents that testify the authenticity of present or past. Rather, the artist traditions they represent are here collected together with the traumas of the region, with everything that was repressed by collective consciousness and repeated in the unconscious. A number of important Eastern European artists are Kult that you can see here, or Sofia Kulik, or Julius Kohler, or Lia Perzhovsky, among many, have devoted a large part of their work to creating archives that today serves vitally important sources of knowledge about unofficial art and the conditions of its production in the countries under socialism. We can trace the Eastern European traditions of art archives developed by artists out of the need to contextualize their own art practices all the way to the present day. Here I want to mention especially the archives created by the group Irving, you know, the part of Neue Slowenische Kunst, which I think are important not only because they include marginalized traditions, but also because they are explicitly concerned with the principles of marginalization and the creation of history. And of course they are they don't look like archives. That's why I also dislike at least some of the words. So the question of how ideology and capital manipulate us through images has been an object of Irving's research right from the beginning. In 1984, they began work on the painting series Was ist Kunst, which after its completion in 1996 have rise to a new series of works called Irving Icons. The series Was ist Kunst is an archive of images that derive from a variety of contexts such as folk art, the Russian avant-garde, communist symbols, Nazi art and modernism. The members of Irving saw the series as a kind of slot machine which the different in which the different motives were colliding with each other for more than a decade. So, as to generate in 1996 the Irving icons, the motives in Vasi's schools that were most often repeated by five members of Irving. In this manner, the group specified five motives which they have been repeating in their work from that time to now. The process is presented by Irving in a grid, so this is already the installation with the icons, and here you can see the, it's very different than the Vasi's Kunst, so here you can see the grid of horizontal and vertical lines, which remind us that there is no single archetypical icon. There is only a classification table of images. In Irving's grid, which acts as a system of differences, the five main motives that emerge after a decade of collisions in Vasi's Kunst appear in a horizontal line. So you can see the cross, the sword, the marriage between the wars, the deer, and the coffee drinker. So that, there is also another motif of the drummer which is not included here. So this is the horizontal line of the motifs that became the icons, and in the vertical lines you can see the different variations of the same icon by each of the members of the group Irving. Irving classification system is based on common generic principles tied to the eclectic cultural tradition of small nation. Another project in which Irving illustrated how history emerged was East Art Map from 2002-2005. Here the goal was to map Eastern European art from the past 50 years. We invited experts and artists from different Eastern European countries to work with them by proposing the most important artists from their own countries and designating the connections between local artists as well as their connections with Western artists. The results were then put on the map, with red lines, as you can see, showing the connections between individual, and blue lines, those between the groups and movements, let's say. Even at the first glance, we see that the map is not particularly systematic, and that many artists have been left without any connections. In their introductions to the company book, so you can see that book, this is installation on the first floor, you can see in our museum of the whole project, and the book is on the table. So in their introduction to that book, in which various texts deal with specific topics related to Eastern European art, Irving assessed the results of the mapping project. They described their map of Eastern European art as an arbitrary word, since other names might have appeared on it as well. They also found that for the most part of the selectors had not provided information about the relations between local artists or comparisons between East and West. They also noticed that different selectors had used very heterogeneous, that is, unsystematic criteria in their selection. Finally, they said that they were not surprised by such results, which were, after all, the consequences of several decades of Eastern European isolation. Despite the fact that the selection of the represented artists were not made by Irving themselves, but by the curators and artists that they had invited, one of the key results of the project is surely the group's discovery that it is, at least currently, impossible to forge a collective narrative of Eastern European art. The Irving group have themselves, since the early 90s, carried out many projects that where they try to determine the connection of Eastern European artists both with each other and with the artists from other areas. All this served as the effort to construct a history, connections, referential fields, and collisions that generate the icons, without which we could not imagine at least the histories written up to now. This has always been the crucial importance in this construction. For future histories, it seems one of the essential questions will be the dilemma of the collection versus the archive, a referential system of artifacts versus a heterogeneous apparatus of remembering.